Simon Armitage has been writing smart, witty, stark poetry for over 30 years now, observing, watching, commenting on Britain and British people. Much of his work is rooted in the north of England, where he still lives, keeping his distance from the cultural and literary establishment, although he's now something of a national treasure with a CBE to prove it. But I wonder, is being a poet something of a thankless task? Where is poetry now? Is it slowly being suffocated by a lack of understanding, public interest, a lack of money? It's a cliche to say that modern poetry isn't valued, but to find out whether it is, we conducted a pretty unscientific poll. Do you know any poetry?
What do you mean poetry?
You know, can you quote me a bit of a poem?
Yes. Something, something beyond the yonder breaks. It is the eastern. I'm trying to do Shakespeare here, by the way.
Okay.
Yeah, great. I know I'm joking. I don't know any poetry.
Do you know of any poets?
Edward Thomas.
Who's Edward Thomas? Or was Edward
Welsh,
Thomas?
Anglo-Welsh poet. I know that because my friend wrote an email this morning.
Got any poetry books at home?
Yeah, I bought my girlfriend a book of love poems.
Did you?
Yeah.
And which sort of poets?
A compilation.
Which sort of poets were in it? Did it have the desired effect?
Probably did what it required.
Right, okay. But, so poetry has its uses?
It does have its uses.
Is it a shame that more people don't like poetry, buy poetry books, go to poetry recitals?
Well, what I see is that poetry can give you a lot of fun and give you good feelings, and if you're very deeply in sorrow, a poet can always give you some cheer, so in that way it's a bit chill.
So in your GCSEs we're talking about, yeah?
Yeah.
You did Wilfred Owen,
yeah.
And Sylvia Plath.
I don't remember that Wilfred dude.
And what did you get from Sylvia Plath?
Well, I got something. She was depressed, obviously, and that's how she killed herself. Jeez, I don't know why she was so depressed though. What was up with that?
Simon Armitage, do you go along with the idea that not nearly enough people know about poetry, let alone value it?
Well, that's a difficult one, because if everybody sitting on the bus or the tube in the morning was reading a book of poems, I don't think I would be writing it, and I don't think I would value it particularly. There's something about poetry which is oppositional, and it's a form of dissent. I mean, even in its physical form, you know, it doesn't reach the right-hand margin, it doesn't reach the bottom of the page. There's something a little bit obstinate about it, and I think it's the literary equivalent of the awkward squad. So, you know, there is simply a level beyond which it cannot go. Having said that...
Is that to say that... Do you mean, therefore, that if everyone was reading poetry on the tube in the morning, it would be the poetic equivalent of Coldplay or something? I mean, that's what you mean?
I think what I mean is that it wouldn't be poetry. You know, poetry has always had a complex relationship with language, and it's alternative, it's independent, it is simply and cannot be a mainstream art form. I mean, for example, it requires concentration. That doesn't appeal to everybody. Not everybody wants to look at these little bits of squirreled away language and focus on them. But at the same time, you know, because it's the thing I value almost more than anything, I do believe there is a huge amount of fantastically good writing out there which goes unregarded and in some cases unread.
When I went back in preparation for this interview to your Faber anthology selected poetry, one thing that struck me about it was the regular appearance of violence and murder. I mean, Hitcher has the lines, "I let him have it on the top road out of Harrogate, one with the head, then six times with the crook lock in the face and didn't even swerve." There's a poem called Sagitta, have I pronounced that correctly? "From nowhere and nothing, a man was slashed in the face with a Stanley knife one evening."
Oh, yeah. This is a poem about the constellation of Sagittarius.
Ah, okay. Where do those images come from? You worked for a while as a probation officer. Is there some of that in there?
I think there definitely is. I also think that I grew up in quite a sort of violent generation. You know, you think back to I think of the 70s have been violent times. You know, in towns, in cities, at football matches, I just remember people scrapping all the time, and at school as well. And then, yeah, I went on to be a probation officer in Greater Manchester, and obviously confronted on a daily basis with either violence itself or images of violence or evidence of violence. And that certainly filtered through into the work. I suppose...
Was it unsettling writing poems of that kind?
Well, maybe I was coming to terms with it. I don't know. You know, doing the job during the day and then, you know, getting it out of my system or something at night, or processing it in my own way. You know, trying to put my own spin or my own take on these experiences. I mean, I am interested in violence and why people are violent to each other. And I think that can be a real connective energy in a poem as well, even when the poem's actually discussing something else. But yeah, I wouldn't shy from the fact that, you know, those first two or three books do have that strand running through them.
How do you think Britain compares now? I mean, you're a few years older than me, but I completely share that sort of memory of the 70s and the early 80s between football hooliganism and the things you'd see on telly, things like the Sweeney. There was the sort of birth of what sort of social realist drama on TV that was also very violent. A lot of people getting punched and so on. And I wonder now how you think Britain compares.
It doesn't.
Because we still seem to be quite an angry little island where, well, you know, people very often fly off the handle at each other. And
it doesn't feel as physically violent. I mean, I don't witness it. I don't encounter it in the way that I used to. You know, I still go to a lot of football. I spend a lot of time in cities. You know, in the evening, albeit usually coming out of a poetry reading, which can have its own sort of violence. But it might be to do with the life that I lead now. You know, the fact that I'm older and I know where to go and where not to go, etc., etc. I think psychologically we're a more violent society. I think we're a crueler and more cynical place, and I think, you know, there are huge cracks in society, and there is anger between people. And I mean, you know, we're talking about this just coming out of those recent riots, and however you might want to dismiss those riots as just sort of wanton hooliganism, people don't do that for no reason, you know. If people think it's okay to kick a glass window in and go and get some training shoes, that comes from somewhere.
Where do you think it comes from?
I think it's attitudinal. And I think it's fostered both in the family and in the state.
You buy the idea that somehow that's a reflection of the acquisitive people that a lot of us have become, and that it speaks of a society that wants instant gratification and sod the consequences.
I do, yeah. I don't think it comes out of nothing. Yeah.
Let me ask you to finish. Firstly, about the fact that you live in Yorkshire. Philip Larkin, a poet that I've written quite a lot about and sort of immersed myself in, he stayed put in Hull and other places because he felt that being away from the sort of metropolitan noise was crucial to the poetic endeavour. Is there a sense in which you have stayed put in Yorkshire for that reason? That it's less distracting and you're away from the mainstream? Given what you said about poetry having an awkward relationship to where the mass of culture sits. It's good to be at a distance, in other words.
There is definitely some of that. You know, you can filter out a lot of the noise up there. I think originally I stayed in the north because it was convenient. You know, after I'd finished college, I didn't have a job. I started working as a volunteer. The kind of system up there was just easier for me to stay in than try and head off and make a life somewhere else. But as time has gone past, I've realised it's not just a sort of comfort thing, that it works for me up there. It feels like a good vantage point for writing. I also write a lot about that part of the world. I don't feel as if I'm its spokesperson. I don't want to wear
the cloth cap. Simon Armitage, they always say.
They do, and sometimes what they mean is that I am writing about the North, and that is a fair description of the work, but sometimes that's as if it's a sort of subdivision of poetry itself, and you know, that's when I get a bit arsey. But I mean, you know, living in Yorkshire is not a bizarre choice. I know it might seem sort of exotic and weird to some people, but to me, it's completely normal. Also, you know, a lot of my touchstones and the people who I read and believe in are from that neck of the woods. I'm talking about, you know, Hockney, Harrison, Hughes, Moore, Hepworth, Alan Bennett, you know, people, W.H. Auden, people who've had a, you know, a sound and really intense career, full of integrity for their art, but have had the common touch as well.
Right.
You know, have wanted to communicate with people, and that's the setting I see myself in.
Living where you do, how you feel looking ahead through the next 4 or 5 years, and what's going to happen to places very close to where you live, Wakefield and Huddersfield and so on. Because the North-South divide's being talked about again now in a way that it wasn't 9 or 10 years ago.
Yeah, it has come up. I know that because I seem to be Radio 4's North-South divide correspondent. You know, every time something comes up on the North-South divide, they ring me up for a quote. Well, I was saying earlier, those cracks seem to be widening. We're running out of cash. We're running out of ideas. You know, the whole project looks a bit flimsy at the moment. And you see that when you walk down the street. You know, you see the charity shops moving in again. You see empty shopping malls. I don't know what's going to happen. I'm not a seer. They say it goes in cycles and phases, and maybe it does. But to me, there's a kind of whiff of rot about the whole thing. And I wonder if that applies generally. You know, to the West. Maybe it's over.
Will that find its way into your poetry?
I would think so.
Does that mean it definitely will? Well, you obviously feel strongly about it, and it sits in quite a sort of central place in your mind, what you're talking about.
I'm not programmatic in my writing. I don't think, you know, I need to write a book about the collapse of Western civilization. But but
one gets a sense of prevailing social conditions from a lot of your poems.
And mood as well. You know, even if you're only writing about a teapot, it might still be in there.
Simon Armitage, thank you very much.